What I'm going to hand out is four versions in the English, all right? Four versions so you can compare them. This is what I've done before when I've given this lecture. So on one side, we're doing two chapters, chapter one, chapter two. And you'll be able to compare the New Revised Standard, the Revised English Bible, the New American Bible, which is the one we use in our liturgy, and the New Jerusalem Bible. They're all here, and you can compare the different translations. So as you can already suspect, and as you will see, this is going to be very much concentrated on words, etymological and scholarly work, look at the actual text, in addition to the interpretations of the mystics and fathers of the church, and the Greek and Latin and Hebrew. So it's going to be and the thought is going to be pretty intense, I hope. As most of you have read, this is what I said in the bulletin. So this is an ardent love poem that was almost not included in the canon of scripture by Jews and Christians, and is barely quoted today, unfortunately. But the magnificent Song of Songs was central to the Catholic liturgy, as we'll see in just a second. I'm going to begin with a chant from the Song of Songs, from the Carthusian liturgy, and to the life and writings of great mystics such as St. Gregory of Nyssa, whom I'll be quoting today, St. Bernard of Clairvaux, I'll be quoting also, and St. John of the Cross. So come and explore, which is what you've done, with me, the original Hebrew text, the Greek and Latin tradition, the writings of the saints, and contemporary scholarship as well. Two chapters a day, so eight chapters, four weeks, and we'll finish on the Feast of St. John, the Beloved Disciple, which is fitting. So let me hand out these first. Even if you have brought your own copy, please take one, because there's enough for everybody, and I want you to be able to follow in. If you have any questions on the text based on what you're reading here, please feel free to raise it, because I'll be up for it. So let's pass them around. I also have middle-sized paper, but that some of the little footnotes were left off, so I'll stick with these for a moment. Well, it probably is. Which version is that? Is that the Jerusalem Bible, the American Bible?
Yeah.
Okay, well, so you have one of them there. There are three others there for you. So I'm going to begin with a prayer for the Holy Spirit to come down and enlighten us and be with us. And then I'll be singing the chant that I mentioned and give a brief comment on it. It's actually a text which we'll be singing today, the text that I'll be singing from the Vulgate. So come, Holy Spirit. Fill the hearts of your faithful people. Kindle in them the fire of your love. Send forth your spirit, and they shall be created, and you shall renew the face of the earth. Let us pray. Father, you instruct the hearts of your faithful people by the light of the Holy Spirit. Grant us in the same spirit to savor what is right, and always to rejoice in his consolation. And we ask this through Christ our Lord. Seat of wisdom, pray for us. And that's Mary, of course. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. This text is from chapter 2, as we'll see, let's see what one of the translations might be. If you look at it. Take the Revised English Bible, 2:5. Sustain me with raisins, revive me with apples, for I am faint with love. And we'll be looking at that text more in detail in a moment, but that's this the translation. Sustain me with raisins. Actually, in the Vulgate, it has sustain me with flowers. Anyway, we'll look at that. And revive me with apples, for I am faint with love. So this is the chant. Uchite me florim stipate memor says in the Latin, I languish with love, languio, I'm languishing with love. That's the second response from the Common of the Virgin Mary. That should already surprise you a little bit. But this was common, the text most used in the liturgy for Mary was the Song of Songs. So out of the 12 responses, for example, in this common, 6 of the 12 are from the Song of Songs. 4 of them are from the great nuptial Psalm 45, which is also, again, about a royal wedding. One is from Luke's Gospel, all generations will call me blessed, and another one is from the book of Sirach, again, about wisdom speaking, seed of wisdom, as we just said. So what is this all about? Well, we'll come to that in just a second, how that fits in. So obviously I want to give some background and some, you know, present scholarly view of what the Song of Songs is in itself before we start looking at the text. Now, Song of Songs, Shir HaShirim in Hebrew, is another way of saying, wow, this is the best song ever. This is the greatest of songs. Just like the Holy of Holies in the temple is the holiest place, so the Song of Songs is the best song. That's the idea behind it. Now, as to the date, we don't know the authorship, as with most books of the Bible, almost all of them, we don't know who actually wrote them, even though they're attributed to Solomon or Moses or whatever. And this is actually called the Song of Songs of Solomon. So again, that's just an attribution because he was, you know, the wise one. But we don't know who wrote it. It seems like it was written about the same time as other wisdom literature, or certainly after the late prophets, after the return from exile anyway, in probably around the 3rd century BC. And the best indications of that are the language and the grammar. It's a late grammar in Hebrew. Some of the words has a lot of Aramaisms, Aramaic words from there, borrow words. Seems to show the influence of Hellenistic culture, you know, late Greek culture, in some of its imagery and style. Especially because of the language, it's pretty conclusive that it's a late composition compared to the rest of Scripture. So maybe the 3rd century BC. And it also seems to be, you know, as has been pointed out, you know, this is a love poem or a series of love poems. People debate whether it was brought together from various sources or whether one person edited it or one person composed it. They have the same argument about some of the great poetry of, you know, Homer and others too. It would seem that, you know, it seems unified enough that one person at least brought it all together, if not actually wrote it. But again, we don't know who might have done that. The most striking thing about it, in a sense, is that God is never mentioned. God doesn't appear at all. God is there, but God is not mentioned explicitly, just like in daily life, God is there, but you usually don't notice it. So that was what caused both Greek and both Jewish and Christian authorities to say, you know, we can't have this. You know, this is lewd. I mean, it doesn't even mention marriage. These are just two lovers trysting, you know, with each other. And you know, while both Jewish and Christian theology, you know, puts a great deal into, you know, the fact that God can be operative and very present in a marriage between husband and wife. The marriage of Christ and the church, etc., being participating in that. Even that is not what's really put forth here. And then when you get, you know, the Platonizing influences on the fathers of the church, you know, who Augustine and, of course, the Greek fathers, who are very much influenced by Platonism, and even more, there's this sense that it can't just be about, a bodily union or an emotional attachment. It has to be a deeper meaning. So the reason that in both Jewish and the Christian tradition, it was included in scriptures and was so prominent in mystical writing is because it's taken as an allegory of the union of God and his people, and of course the great prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Hosea, they all have this imagery of the virgin daughter Jerusalem and God being the bridegroom who woos his people during the early years in the Exodus. That was their courtship. And then the exile was a divorce, and then God took them back again, Isaiah 54, for example. So the imagery of God and his people being, you know, in a marital bond with the ups and downs of that over the centuries is very, very central to the prophets. And so that aids, you know, the interpretation of it that way. And then, of course, in our own Christian tradition, based on the quote from Ephesians 5 that I just gave you from Paul, that this marriage, you know, the union of husband and wife is a participation in an image of the union of Christ and his church. That's what it's taken to be. Now, just understand a few things here. Calling, as we see at the beginning of chapter 2, the bride a lily of the valley or a rose of Sharon or something like that, that's not allegory. That's the literal sense. That's part of the literal sense. Poetry's image, similes and metaphors of poetry is part of the literal sense of Scripture. That's not the allegory. The allegory is taking the lily or something to be a symbol of Mary or the symbol of some aspect of your inner life. That's allegory. So remember, poetry with its imagery and similes and all of that is the literal sense, still. It's when you use it in the theological allegory, in the allegory in the theological sense, that you can properly use that word, you know, interpreting Scripture. Now, you already had an allegorizing tendency in Judaism with Philo in Alexandria. He was a contemporary of Jesus, Philo the Jew. Now, the Alexandrian school, as it continued on into Christianity, became the center of the allegorization. You know. So Origen, who was a 3rd century mystic and theologian, perhaps in my view and others' view, the greatest theologian of the first millennium of Christianity, even more than Augustine, or at least his equal, wrote many treatises. Because of a certain historical and political issues, many of his works were destroyed. I won't go into that now, so we don't have a lot left of his commentary on the Song of Songs, but he did write one. His disciple, the one who learned from him very much, was Gregory of Nyssa in the 4th century, one of the Cappadocian fathers. He wrote a complete commentary on the Song of Songs, which I read with great delight when I was a young Jesuit in the original Greek. It's my favorite patristic work. And you can find excerpts from that in a book called From Glory to Glory, which was edited by one of my teachers at Fordham at the time when I was studying there. He's dead now, but called From Glory to Glory. The quotes I'll be using myself are from an edition that the Carthusians use. At the end of each night office during Advent, they read an excerpt from St. Gregory of Nyssa's Canticle of Canticles. So it fits the season very well that we're doing that. And I'll be quoting 2 or 3 of them here today. So he was the main one that's famous in the Greek church for a commentary on the Song of Songs. And he had, by the way, been married once before he entered the priesthood and became a bishop later. He was also the brother of St. Basil the Great. In the Latin tradition, as I mentioned, you have St. Bernard of Clairvaux with his Doctor Mellifluus, his mellifluous Latin, which I just love reading. So in the monastery, I read all 84 sermons of his in Latin on the Song of Songs, which are edited. You can actually find an English translation published by Cistercian Publications in 4 volumes, in case you're interested, you know, in seeing what he has to say. It's a tissue of Scripture. So that's also available in English. And then St. John of the Cross is also one who he had the Song of Songs read to him on his deathbed, because this was the summation to him of what our relationship with God is about. And he wrote his own Song of Songs, as you may know, called the Spiritual Canticle, in which he kind of, you know, it's kind of a gloss, kind of his own take on it based on that same kind of imagery. So that's all very beautiful stuff. We can certainly say, and this is where debate comes in, was it written as an allegory? We don't know. We don't know. It doesn't have to be. As I just said, in the authentic Christian and Jewish tradition, romantic love, love between a husband and wife is very much a place where God is encountered. This you might argue goes even beyond that and says, any kind of a passionate love is already some kind of an experience of transcendence. Now that can be debated, obviously. Some would say that. Others, would say, well, wait a minute, you got to be careful. It's not just lust or whatever it might be, Augustine, etc. We could speak about, the insights of the East, about bodily love can actually become, this is called the tantric tradition in Buddhism and Hinduism, that bodily love can actually be an experience of God directly, not just a participation somehow, but actually an experience of God. That's pretty lofty spirituality, if it's true. But what we will be concentrating on then primarily, apart from the obvious literal sense, the actually get words, what's actually said, is the allegorical tradition. Is the allegorical tradition by St. Gregory and St. Bernard and other authors. So that's going to be our approach. I'm going to be using primarily the best text I've found, the Song of Songs, a new translation by Ariel and Shana Block. So they're Jewish, modern Jewish writers. Has a wonderful translation and a lengthy commentary that goes into the sense of the words, as best we can discern it. So if you want, the Hebrew and the English on opposite sides, so it's a very free translation, but they explain all their choices in the commentary. So if you're looking for, a scholarly modern take on the Hebrew and a translation based on that by the Jewish, modern Jewish spiritual tradition, I certainly recommend that. And that's the one I'll be mainly using for the understanding of the text itself. Other people read, Calvin. Calvin couldn't stand the thing, and there are many who rejected it, but it was nonetheless included. You get the cautions like St. Gregory of Nyssa, who says this: are you one of those who would grasp the mystery of the Song of Songs? Well, then first you have to follow the counsel of Paul, putting off the old man with his works and his lusts, as you might put off a garment of misery. Next, by the purity of your life, you must put on the garment of splendor that the Lord manifested on the day of his transfiguration on the mountain. Transfigured humanity, in other words. Better still, put on our Lord Jesus Christ himself, as Paul says, with his holy tunic of love. Be transfigured in his image. Be freed from your animal nature and be made divine. This done, hear the mystery of the Song of Songs. Enter the holy marriage chamber, wearing the white robe of pure and honest thoughts. Let nobody bring hither feelings inspired by the flesh and its senses. For he whose spirit is not properly arrayed to attend the divine marriage, he will become the captive of his own thoughts. He will debase the pure words of bridegroom and bride to the level of irrational and animal passions. Such is my warning as I approach the threshold of this mystical contemplation. For in this book, the soul is in a sense garbed as a bride-to-be. She presses forward to a spiritual union with God in which body and matter play no part. Well, it's true, you need to be transfigured and transformed and elevated and sublimated and all of that. That's part of our spiritual growth. But to say a spiritual union in which the body and matter play no part, well, that's just Platonism. Right. That's I put forth the idea that that's, from our point of view today, an exaggeration. So that the idea is, as he's really saying, be transfigured, put on the Lord Jesus Christ, put on the body of Christ, put on the resurrected body of Christ, be transformed into Christ, body and spirit, and then you'll be able to understand and experience the canticle of saying. So that's a good example of the type of sentiment that was put out there by those who did accept the canticle, the Song of Songs, but with the cautions that were very common at the time on how to approach this. It's kind of like the Jewish rabbi saying you can't do Kabbalah until you're 50. It's the same kind of idea. You're going to misunderstand it when you're going to mistreat the text. So, duly warned, are you ready? All right. So, I already mentioned the Song of Songs, which is Solomon. All right. Now, I once read some writer who was saying a priest, it's probably a true story, a priest went up into the pulpit one day at the daily mass with all the little old ladies saying the rosaries in the front row, and he started by saying, "Let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth." And the ladies were shocked. They almost had a heart attack. Because, what are you saying that in church for? What porn channel did you get that from? But he was making the point that this is scripture. So, but it is a rather, you're jumping right into the middle of things. So there's no introduction, there's no setting the stage, there's just, whoo, let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth. And it's a wonderful indication of St. Bernard's theology and the way he approached this. His commentary on that verse is the most famous and the most interesting that I've ever found. So right in the beginning he says, so what do we mean by that? Okay, so we're talking about God here. So the mouth of God, the kisses of his mouth, the mouth of God is his word. Mouth, word. So the mouth of God is his word. He speaks his word from all eternity as the second person of the Trinity, the word of God. But he says, he can't kiss me with his mouth, because that's divine, it's too far distant. So that's why he says, the author says, let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth. Not with his mouth. Let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth. And he says, the kiss of his mouth is the incarnation, is the humanity of Christ. So the kiss of the word to humanity is the humanity of Jesus. So if he kisses me with his humanity, then I can do that. That's possible. So isn't that ingenious? You know, it's taking what's really just a cognate object, kiss with the kisses. Grammatically, it's not striking. But he takes the whole theology out of it by using each word and interpreting each word. So is that what the author meant? Well, probably not. Probably not. But you see how you can build a beautiful, beautiful theology there into, you know, the love God has for his people in Christ and through Christ, which is his kiss to humanity. Christ is God's kiss to humanity and his kiss to each one of us. So to make clearer then too, you know, in the allegorical tradition, beginning with ours and especially Gregory of Nyssa, there are four levels of the literal sense. The allegorical sense would be applied to this God and his people, to Christ and his church. Then what's called the tropological or moral sense would be that is applied to the individual as members of God. So the church says to Jesus, to God, let him kiss me with the kiss of your mouth. But the individual can say it as well. And the fourth sense, the anagogical sense, is as it's applied to the fulfillment in the kingdom of heaven. When the final bride of Christ, the New Jerusalem, comes down out of heaven from God, so that whole imagery is sustained right to the very end of the Revelation. Now might be a good time to just point out about the application to Mary. The Marian sense interpretation of the Song of Songs, which I say was absolutely central to the liturgy of the church in the Middle Ages. The office of Mary and the liturgy for this feast of Mary. Has, you know, her in what's called the sponsa verbi, sponsa Christi, that she is the spouse of the Word. That she is the image of the Church, the mother of the Church, the firstborn, the image of the Church herself, as we say even today. And as such, if Christ's love for the Church, then it's Christ's love for Mary. So she's the spouse of Christ. But you see, that gets into a little bit of trouble in terms of popular piety, because it's a little too beautiful. Jesus is marrying his mother. So whenever Pope John Paul spoke about Mary as the spouse of anybody, it was spouse of the Holy Spirit. He didn't want to talk about Mary as the spouse of Christ, because so many people misunderstand it. But that was absolutely central to the understanding of the Church and the liturgy in the Middle Ages. So we have to get beyond, you know, the roles and, you know, of gender and generation and relationship, which is what Jesus says all through the gospel, isn't it? Whoever does the will of my Father is my mother, and my sister, and my brother. And in the Trinity, there are two guys who have the Holy Spirit somehow between them. It sounds very gay. So, you know, we have to get away from the limitations of our understanding, you know, of the, you know, human relationships. That's why Jesus is always relativizing family. Let the dead bury their dead, you know, that kind of thing. Leave your father and your mother and come follow me, and leave your wife and your children. It's pretty radical. And on a mystical level, you have to realize that all these things become relativized and brought into a higher context, and you can't hold on to the same kind of reference points that you do, in your ordinary daily life. Where, you know, obviously, rules of relationship and everything do apply. But on the mystical level, you know, you have to realize to get beyond that. Mary, like all the other members of the church, is also we're all called to be men and women. We're called to be the spouse of Christ. We're called to be the bride of the Lamb. And that's how this is understood. And that's, of course, what Bernard is saying is happening in this first verse. Let him kiss me with his own humanity. Let me enter into the mystery of Jesus' own humanity. Okay. For your love is better than wine, and your anointing oils are fragrant. They make a very good case here. You know, the love. The word for your love and beloved here is dodi. You may have heard that David. The name David comes from that. It means beloved in Hebrew. David. And here it's a plural noun, dodeka, which means your love loves. So it just says your love here. Why is it plural? As you see in the Jerusalem Bible, they have the right translation on the number 4 column. Your lovemaking is sweeter than wine. Okay. In Hebrew, in the plural, to use that way, it means your lovemaking. That's plural. Les amours in French. So do you have a question?
Yeah, I have a question. In the Douay Rheims Bible, which is one I've used, they say your breasts are better than wine, and that's the double. That will give you the plural.
No, I'm glad you brought that up. I would have forgotten to mention that. In the Septuagint, in the Greek version, they have mastoi, which means your breasts, and ubra is what it also has, the breasts in the Vulgate, the Latin Vulgate. That's correct. So the Vulgate was simply following the Greek, but the Greek mistranslated it. It doesn't mean that specifically. So the word in Hebrew means love or lovemaking. So I'm glad you brought that up, yeah. Because the Latin and the Greek would give you a different impression there. Is sweeter than wine, okay? Literally better than wine. And your, and as regards scent, your oils are good. Your oils are fragrant. So the commentators normally apply these things, you know, your oils, like the scent of the breath of the Holy Spirit, the odor of the fragrance of virtue, the fragrance of God, and the different virtues that we have. That's the way these different oils and smells and perfumes and gems and plants and spices and all these things throughout were interpreted as applying, you know, to qualities of the soul and the qualities of God himself. So that's good to realize that right now. Then your name is as oil poured out. Now we're not sure. They say with the turak poured out. If that's the right translation, but most translations do have that. Unguentum effusum in the Latin. Your is oil poured out is your name. Now. Gregory of Nyssa has a couple of good interpretations of that. Your name is as oil poured out, is given to the world. Okay. So Jesus emptied himself and poured himself out, you know. And so your name, which is Christ, of course, is poured out on the world. So it's immediately speaking about the generosity and abundance of God's love, which is poured out on the world. And Gregory also says something very interesting. He says, taken from the point of view of the transcendence of God, your name is just like oil poured out, there's no more oil, it's empty, and all we have is just this fragrance left in the cup. After the oil is poured out, we just have this fragrance. Because God is so transcendent, we can't actually grasp him, but we can get a little fragrance of God after it's been poured out. So if you catch a little whiff of God's goodness here and there, that's the way it works. I think that's a beautiful idea, a beautiful sentiment there. And then it says, therefore the maidens love you. Then it says, draw me after you. Try me poste in the Vulgate. Pull me after you, drag me after you. Same word that was taken to mean Moses' name, which is Mashak in Hebrew. Moses, one of the interpretations of Moses' name is that he was pulled out of the water by Pharaoh's daughter. So draw me after you, let us run, Kuremos, let us run. So there's a sense of joy and exuberance and energy as the lovers pursue each other. Draw me after you and let us run. And the king has brought me into his chambers, marriage chambers really, although it's not that clear in the Hebrew. And then it has, and I jumped when I saw this, Nagila Wenismakabo Bach. Nagila Wenismakabo is, as they point out, is a quote from Psalm 118, which we use every Sunday. Yeah, stone which the builders rejected become the cornerstone. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We use that Sanctus, that's the same psalm. It says, this is the day the Lord has made, which we sing all during Easter week, right? That great love affair with the resurrected Christ and his people. Let us rejoice and be glad in it in this day, is the quote from Psalm 118. And this is almost the same thing. Let us rejoice and be glad in you. So, again, a Hebrew hearing this would think of Psalm 118 and think of that whole thing and then apply it to this particular situation here. So, let us rejoice and be glad in you. And I will recount. That's not always the way they translate it. Extol, you know, let us praise, extol your love. Yeah. So, it literally means I will publicize. I will publicize your love making again. That's the same word, which is better than wine. And you know, the whole idea of intoxication of love, you know, here is wonderful here. Love being like wine, and certainly the Holy Spirit has been compared by the fathers of the church to wine, and not, of course, the Eucharistic wine, the blood of Christ, all that same imagery of love being intoxicated. And then, this is very interesting, the very last verse on this page here, it says, rightly do they love you. And that's the correct translation. How rightly you are loved, etc. How right it is to love you. It looks like a plural noun in Hebrew or an adverb or something. Nesharim, but it is rightly they love you. Now, in the Vulgate, they took it as a proper noun, and it's not recte diligente. They rightly love you. It's recte diligente, which is the righteous love. So it's not rightly do they love you, it's the righteous love. So they moralized it by misinterpreting the Hebrew. Okay. And in the Greek, which is even funnier, it's an abstract noun. Righteousness loves me. Righteousness loves. Alright. So that's the way that the text was, because the word is a little unusual in the Hebrew, they didn't know how to translate it, and they came up with these various things, all having to do with rightness. But yeah, what the word really means is, with good reason, they love you, which is much more, a little freer than some of the other things you might come up with. Any questions so far?
I have a question. I was just going to ask you if we wait till then for questions, but you just ask for a question, I can give you a question.
Just one.
Okay.
Maybe I don't say I'm going to answer it now, it depends.
Okay. This goes just a little bit back when we were speaking about spouses, the whole imagery of being the spouse in the mystical world, of being the spouse,
yes,
of
Christ.
The Lord.
Christ, yes.
Can there be multiple spouses? Could I be the spouse of Christ and have an earthly spouse.
Well, of course,
or even lovers.
Well, of course. Well, we'll leave the lovers out for a minute, but in terms of even Catholic theology, you have, as what Paul says, a human marriage is a participation in the marriage of Christ and His Church. So it's a way of living that out. And remember, you know, whatever applies to the church, then it also applies to the individual and the individual couples in this case. So yes, that's all very possible, and even admirable, a very great way to live your spirituality. So let's go back to the text. Unless someone else has a comment. Now this is good. This verse became famous in the 60s in the civil rights movement, and you know it's always important. I'm black but beautiful. Okay, but it's even better than that because it doesn't say but. It just says I am black and beautiful, which is the way it should be. Right? Any human being is beautiful no matter what the color of the skin, maybe even because of different colors of the skin. So she's saying that she's dark. And I'm beautiful, daughters of Jerusalem. I am beautiful. And she says, I'm like the tents of Solomon, the tents of Kedar, which is an image that comes up, and like the tapestries, or depends how they're translating it, tent curtains of Solomon. I just said Shalman here. That's just one way of translating Shalomo. So she's comparing herself. You will find that sometimes the images in the Song of Songs from the desert culture are a little, I'm as beautiful as a tent, really? the idea here, as they point out in the commentary, is that the black goat wool that was used for tents was very beautiful and very rich, a mark of wealth. So she is comparing herself to something exotically beautiful here. And they were the black goat's hair. But then she says, "Well, don't look upon me as just dark. You know, the sun has literally. This is a word that in modern Hebrew they point out means sunburn. Actually, means to sunburn you. The sun has burned me. The sun has gazed on me and tanned me. So she's made dark by the sun. And this is some of the fathers of the church take this in the negative sense. You know, that the bride is first starts being by being sinful and dark." Dark always seems to be a symbol of evil, and unfortunately, because it really shouldn't be. But take it as so she's starting out sinful, and she's that God loves her anyway, and is going to purify her. That's the way it was often interpreted. One thing is to note, though, when she says "I am dark" or "I am black," in Hebrew, and this is something any Hebrew speaker would have picked up, "shachar," which can mean black, also means dawn. So it's the darkness that comes before dawn. Mm-hmm. For example, in Psalm 63, with the first verse, when I said, "My God, I wait for you at light of day," the word is eshachareka. It's all one word. "I wait for you at light of day" is one word in Hebrew. "I'm waiting for you at dawn," eshachareka, the same word. So it has that sense of, it may be dark, but the dawn is coming. And that would be applied to the bride here too. So there's that sense of, even though it's dark, the light is coming. So they would pick up on that right away. Whereas, of course, we don't notice that at all if we're just reading it in translation. And then she has another interesting verses. "The sons of my mother, or my brothers, were angry with me, and they were disputing with me. They placed me as a guard for the vineyards. But my own vineyard, my own vine, I have not kept." So this is sometimes taken to mean, you know, you're put in charge of something in the world or in the church, and you're neglecting your own soul. So that's some of the interpretations have gone that way. You're fulfilling some external task instead of actually taking care of your own vine, your own vineyard. And so it goes on from there. "Tell me, you whom my soul loves." That's a phrase that's going to come up again and again. "You whom my soul loves," as a phrase for the beloved of the die. "Where you pasture your sheep, or where you pasture?" where you make your flock lie down at midday. So here it's noon now already. It's not the break of day. It's noon. And St. John of the Cross himself has a beautiful commentary on this. He says, you know, we're the sheep. We're the ones at the Jesus' pasture. Because it's the bride speaking to the bridegroom. And he says, you pasture your flock at noon when you bring them through your humanity into the eternal brightness of the Word, itself. So at the noon of eternity, where the sun is right overhead and shines most directly and brightly, is, in other words, you're asking for a revelation of God. Pasture me, not just, you know, among the shadows, but bring me all the way up to the sun shining brightly at noon. Asking for, show us the Father, if you will, or reveal yourself to us. Whoever loves me will be loved by my Father. I will come to make myself and manifest myself to him. Okay. Why should I be wandering? I'm not quite sure if that's what that means, but probably, why should I be wandering and lose my way? That's the way the Vulgate has it as well, among the flocks of your companions. So again, why should I be messing around with what other people are doing when I have this direct relationship with you? So if you do not know, now there's a Hebrew idiom here. If you do not know for yourself, teith kilah. If you do not know for yourself, but it looks like an objective pronoun. And that's the way the Vulgate interpreted it. So it's very interesting. It's almost Socratic. If you do not know yourself, O loveliest among women, then do what follows. So it's taken to be very interior, even though it just means, if you don't know where I pasture my flock in the day. But it was taken by the tradition, you know, the Latin tradition. And let me see if it's the same thing in the Greek. Yes, if you do not know yourself. So they interpreted it that way, which is very interesting from an aesthetical, mystical point of view. You have to know yourself, as all the mystics say, before you can reach union with God, which is perfectly true. But really all it's saying in the Hebrew is, if you don't know where I pasture my flock, O lovely one among women, go out, again for yourself, among the in the tracks of the sheep, and pasture your goats. So goats are always a symbol, like the goats and the sheep in the gospel we just had, the goats of that, the stuff that hasn't been reformed in you yet. You're on a lower level here, in the shade of the shepherd's tents, okay? Or alongside the tents of the shepherds. In other words, listen to your priests and bishops, listen to those who are teachers in the church, who are shepherding their own flocks, and pasture your goats to learn from them. If you don't know yourself yet, then maybe you can learn from what other people are saying, you know, about God, and you can learn something. So again, that's the way it was taken. Everybody asleep yet? I hope you don't mind this very word-for-word kind of approach to this, because there's so many variations on the text. And if Frank, if you would keep us alert to what's over there in the Douay Rheims, because the Douay Rheims is, you know, just a translation of the Vulgate, really, and so it's going to have all the errors and all the for better or worse that the Vulgate has. Okay.
Well, you know, any of the translations says lambs, and there's such a difference between a lamb and a goat.
No, not a kid. A kid and a lamb, I mean, they're very similar. But the word actually does mean goat in Hebrew. But I think lamb, they mean a lamb of a goat, not a lamb of a sheep.
Oh.
I think that may be what they're talking about. So, okay. Okay. Now this gets a little tricky here. I likened you, my companion, to my mare of the chariots of Pharaoh. That's literally what it said. So it can get a little complicated in the translation. I compare you, my love, to a mare among Pharaoh's chariots. Okay, that's good. But again, a mare here obviously is a beautiful symbol, especially for those who dwell in the desert, you know, of energy, of beauty, of elegance, you know. So it's not like you probably couldn't go up to a woman today and say, "Oh, you remind me of a horse." You know, any more than you would say, "Oh, you look like a tent." But it really had a different flavor back then. And these are some kind of rare technical words too for jewelry that come up now. So it's something like your cheekbones or your whole side of your face is beautiful with earrings, and your neck with beads, with necklaces. That's kind of seems to be what it's saying. So it's speaking about the jewels on her neck and on her ear, you know, on the side of her face. And it says, "We will make for you earrings of gold set with points of silver." So, and the fathers of the church love this kind of thing. St. John on the Cross too, gold and silver. Gold is the reality, silver's faith, you know, the image, and so they're playing all around with these different meanings of gold and silver here. Just sort of different levels of virtue, different levels of qualities, but the jewelry of the bride.
Natus mea dedit odorem
suum. That's the Gregorian chant of verse 12. While the king was lying in his bed, my nard, my perfume, gave forth its fragrance. And his bed is probably the bride. So he's lying right next to her. And the perfume, nard, you know, spike nard, is also used. Remember that in the gospel when Mary poured the nard over Jesus' feet? Very fragrant.
Mary
of Bethany. Very fragrant perfume. Gave forth its fragrance. So that's an antiphon in the Catholic liturgy. I mean, this is how important it is. But I'm sure none of you knew that. Right? That shows how far we've gotten away from the real tradition. My beloved is to me like a bag of myrrh. So that's the same kind of image. He's lying on her. My beloved is to me like a cluster of myrrh. Like you get these little bags with ribbons with spices inside and things like mm-hmm. that. A cluster of myrrh between my breasts. He dwells there. Yalim used to spend the night, really. So he's dwelling there, lying on her. Sheaf of henna blossoms, again, that same kind of thing. My beloved is to me in the vineyards of En Gedi, which is, again, another symbol of fertility and fragrance. And then you have this beautiful verse. Behold, you are beautiful, my companion. Behold, you are beautiful, and your eyes are doves. Why? Why are your eyes doves? Well, they suggest maybe it's the gentleness or the oval shape of the white, you know, the white of the eye, maybe the white of doves. We're not quite sure. In the Greek and the Latin, they have your eyes are dove's eyes. Your eyes are of doves. You have dove's eyes. So generally, that was often taken to mean because of the dove and the Holy Spirit. The fathers of the church said, well, you really have the Holy Spirit in your eye. You're like the Holy Spirit. You're reflecting the Holy Spirit in your appearance. And then she responds in kind. Well, you're beautiful, my love, and gentle and lovely. And then you know, she has, our bed is green, the roof beams are cedar, our rafters are fir. These are rare words here. You get commentaries by St. Bernard, for example, that point out how fir and cedar wood last a long time, so this is a virtue. It's not easily overthrown, so it's durable, just like the virtues that were given to us and the gifts of the Holy Spirit that are given to us by God. So, we begin chapter 2. Go on the other page. And, you know, it's probably not a house, as they point out. It's probably just trees out in the woods where they're meeting, you know. That kind of imagery. All right, I am a rose, or what is it? It's a tamatzalef, whatever that is. It's one of the wildflowers in the Holy Land. It's not a rose in our sense. And then I am lily, Shoshana, you know, Susanna means lily in Hebrew. The name Susanna is Hebrew. Just like Jonah is dove, we just had Jonah. Your eyes are Jonah, doves, and the lily of the valley. Is that what they say? Well, how do they translate all of that? Your lilies, lily of the valley. They make a very good point. This is where you get the association that Hebrews would have. The only other place that this flower appears, the tabatzalith, translated rose of Sharon, is in Isaiah 35, which is the return of the exiles from Jerusalem, from Babylon, often used on the second or third Sunday of Advent for one of our readings, our return from exile, where the desert blossoms and rejoices and becomes like Sharon or Carmel. So even the word Sharon is here too, which is a fertile valley. So any Hebrew who read this and saw Tzavatzeleth Sharon would say, oh, Isaiah 35. And all the beauty and energy and joy of coming back from exile and the blossoming of the desert would come into their minds. But if we see a rose of Sharon, well, we don't really get that, do we? So that's why you need to go back and these associations that you get in the text. Same thing with Shoshana, the lily, is in the last chapter of Hosea 14. You have the lily, the people blossoming like a lily again. And the cedars are mentioned there as well, which we just had in the previous verse. Plus, the valleys. This is another word that I've only, over time become more familiar with. It's translated as valleys. Literally, it actually means an abyss. So, you know, you're talking about a lily of God, it's growing from the depths that are so deep, it's almost scary, which is true of our inner life. We have all sorts of abysses in them, but they can blossom. Kind of like the lotus growing from the bottom of the pond, you know, in the Eastern tradition. So that's a very, very powerful verse there. And that's the bride speaking. Now it's the bride, the bridegroom speaking. Like a lily among thorns, is my companion, my love, among women. It's like a lily among thorns. Like a lily among thorns. My novice master in the charter house brought me a couple of lilies once for my cell. He said, a thorn among lilies. Which is me. So it's the lily among thorns, lily amid espinas. The reason that verse is so much on our heads is because it was a verse we use every day in the office of mayor. Like lily among thorns is my love among young women. Now, how could that not apply to Mary? So that was particularly easy. That's what the liturgy uses that verse every day. And then so how do they translate it here? Let's see, like an apple tree, an apple tree, an apple tree, an apple tree. It's not an apple tree. There are no apples in Palestine. Tapua, they think, is probably a wild apricot. That's what their suggestion is. So all the association you get with apples and the Garden of Eden and all that stuff is, that doesn't apply. Right? This is Not if they didn't know the vegetation of the Holy Land, so. So, like, and even they're still translating as apple in all four of these verses here. So, like an apricot tree among, like among the trees of the forest, so is my beloved among men, young men. In his shadow, I was delighted and I sat. I was delighted to sit, more likely. I was delighted to sit. And his fruit was sweet to my palate. All right, I don't have to explain that, do I? Kissing, so. But it's a very beautiful verse. And the Father spoke about, you know, this the beloved compared to a tree in the wood. It's like Jesus and the cross, the tree of life, and all of that. They brought out that association. He has brought me to the house of wine. Wow. He's brought me into the house of wine, into the cellar, wine cellar in other words. Again, the intoxication of the wine. And this verse is really funny. The next, his flag or his banner over me is love, is the right way. And there's even a modern song that does that, right? His banner over me is love. My nephew sang it for his first communion. I remember that. They sang that song. His banner over me is love. The Greek has, you ordered over me love, or you set up like a banner. You set up, put in order, is the word actually in Greek. Over me, love, which is kind of close to the Hebrew. But the Vulgate moralized it and said, oh, you put love in order in me. You didn't arrange love as a banner over me, you ordered love within me. So you reformed my love. It's the way that the Vulgate translated it. So you put my love, you purified my love. Whereas all the Hebrew was saying, your banner over me is love, which is a love freedom. Brought me into the house of wine. So I'm going to read Gregory of Nyssa on this. How strongly, how swiftly the soul races and leaps along the divine course, straining towards the things that, like a bear or something, like a horse, straining towards the things that lie before her, never turning to look back, however far ahead she may be. Her thirst is continued, a thirst so intense that the bowl of wisdom cannot satisfy it. Were the whole bowl to be poured into her mouth, she is sure that it would fail to serve her thirst. She asks to be brought into the very cellar of wine, to apply her lips to the vats that run over with tasty wine. You see how he's really going to town with this. Can you imagine going into a wine cellar and putting your mouth under the vat and turning it on? This is what he's talking about. To see the grapes as they're pressed, the vine that has produced such grapes. Now, Jesus as the vine and the grape of the passion, that's what he's bringing up here. And the vine dresser, the Father, who cultivates the true vines, all that, John 15, and has grown a grape so tasty and wholesome, which is Jesus. Jesus is the grape that's pressed in the passion. She's consumed with desire to contemplate the mystery of the bridegroom's raiment reddening as he trod the press. That's a quote from Isaiah 63. I trod the wine press alone and got my garments spattered with blood, which is a symbol of his passion. For the prophet said, Isaiah 63, why are they red, your cloak and your raiment? Red is from the treading of the winepress. That is why she longs to be admitted to the cellar, the scene of the mystery of the wine. Then when she is within, she leaps again towards that which is still higher and asks to be put in subjection to love. Order love over me. The Greek, which is what he's following. Interesting. Okay. So put in subjection to love. Now in the words of John, God is love. In the words of David, to be put in subjection to God is the soul's salvation. So, since I am in the cellar of wine, says the soul, put me in subjection to love. Or rather, put love in command over me. Not bad. So before you fall asleep, any other comments or questions? We're So the banner over me is love. Now the next verse has been a little misinterpreted in several ways before. So it's the verse I started the class today by singing. Fulcite me floribus stipate me malis qui amore languio. That is to say, prop me up with flowers in the Latin, and support me with apples, it says. But remember, we just saw that verse with the bridegroom being compared to an apple tree, but not really. We said it's probably an apricot. So it's the same word here, the tapuach tree. So prop me up with apricots. Sometimes it's been taken to mean stuff me with apples or stuff me with apricots, but the first part with flowers wouldn't seem to mean it's something you're eating. So it's more likely that you're not being supported by nourishing yourself with these things, but rather that you're being supported by the leaves or the branches or even the fruit that you're lying on. It's really vine blossoms here rather than flowers, as the Latin says. Then amore languio, I am sick with love. I am languished, languio. I am in a fever of love, as this translation says. Which, you know, how lovesick one can be. You're not sick of love. You're sick. Sick of love. You're sick in love. You know, you're so you're fainting with love. So that's a good. And Saint Teresa of Jesus often speaks of that. Or there's even this Bernini statue of her, you know, fainting with love, being wounded by love. So, because this Hebrew is very strong. It does mean you're actually sick. You know, you're actually ill. You're sick with love. All right, the next verse. Leva eius sum capite meum et dextera eius amplex habitum. That's the Latin Gregorian version of verse 6. His left hand is under my head, his right hand embraces me. And you can picture that, you know, and that kind of thing. Here again, though, the fathers are very interesting because they interpret left hand in negative sense, you know, gauche, sinister, you know, the whole story, and the right hand being, you know, the more positive. So they collated that with action and contemplation. So your left hand is under my head, meaning my thoughts are being directed by, you know, the action that I'm being inspired to do, whereas the right hand of contemplation is what embraces me and gives me great joy. So it was taken as action and contemplation, the two arms of the beloved. And here's a verse that's going to come up later again, too, verse 7. I adjure you, daughters of Jerusalem, by the gazelles and hinds of the field, that you not arouse, not awaken love, until it so desires. There's a lot of practical wisdom and experience expressed there about love has to be ready, mystically speaking, too. You have to be ready for this. But it's interesting history here in the Greek. The word for gazelle here, tzvi in Hebrew, resembles, especially in the form that we have here in the plural, resembles tzvaoth, tzvi, tzvaoth, because it's actually the word here is actually tzvaoth, the plural of tzvi. So it looks like hosts, God of hosts, Lord of hosts. So the hosts of heaven and the powers of heaven, the virtues of heaven, the angelic hosts, this looks like what's being invoked. And the word for deer here, aril, is also related to a word meaning strength. Virtues, strength, powers, dominions, angelic powers. So in the Greek Septuagint version, that's actually what it has. The powers and virtues of the field. But meaning really the angels. And maybe that's the symbolic meaning of it anyway. But it's very curious, because of the resemblance of the Hebrew words to certain other Hebrew words, it was taken to refer not actually to the animals, but to angelic powers in the Septuagint version. The Latin didn't follow that, but it's true in the Greek. Okay. The next section is very beautiful. It's still used. It's still used today in our Advent liturgy. It's not, so this is not just liturgies from the past. You know, the Gregorian chant from the Office of Mary in the Middle Ages. We're talking about the liturgy of the last week of Advent. Currently, they use this passage to refer to the coming of the Beloved, coming of the Beloved in Advent, which is what it means. It's also used as you may know in as a choice in marriage, the marriage liturgy today, the Song of Songs, which I like to select. And so it says, "The voice of my beloved, here he comes, leaping over the mountains and bounding across the hills." St. Gregory and others take this as the coming of the Son of God, bounding over the mountains, leaping over the hills, again interpreting them, as we just saw a second ago, in terms of angels. So leaping through the angelic hierarchies to get down to us, to on earth, coming, you know, with all the enthusiasm and the joy of a lover, coming to humanity, rejoicing to be among the children of men. And my love is like a gazelle, here we go again, a gazelle or a wild stag. And behold, he's there. Behold, he is standing behind the wall, peering through the windows and gazing through the lattices, or more likely probably the cracks in the stones of the wall. So peering from behind, what do those mean? They were taken to mean the law and the prophets, where the word was already present but only gazing from behind the veil, which reveals and conceals at the same time, of the law and the prophets. But now he's actually coming, you know, through that. There are passages in Gregory of Nyssa that speak about that. What the church learns from the word, while the barrier of the law stands, it receives the rays of the truth through the windows of the prophets and the lattice of the law. The law teaches in types and symbols which form the shadow of good things to come, but do not show forth their very image. So that's the shadow of things to come. And as the letter of the Hebrews says, and then God and Jesus himself is coming. Behind the law comes the truth, following hard on its own symbols. Through the prophets it shines the word upon the church, then it scatters the whole shadowy show of symbols by the revelation of the gospel. The wall between is pulled down. The air of the house mingles with the light of heaven. There's no longer any need for rays to be shone through the windows, for the true light itself shines through the rays of the gospel on all that is within. Speaks again also elsewhere in the same vein, the ray of his brightness through the windows of the prophets and the lattice of the commandments of the law. So that's the way that was interpreted. Now here he is. He calls, literally answers, my beloved answers and says to me, "Arise, my companion, my friend, my beautiful one, come." The word here in Hebrew is kumi. You might remember the phrase in the Gospel when Jesus raises the 12-year-old girl. That's one of the few places the Aramaic is still in the Gospel, untranslated. And it has talitha kumi. Remember kumi, arise, get up. So rise, you know, we're supposed to be rising from wherever we are in the spiritual life, in our ordinary life, and climb up higher. And the phrase comes up again, and in fact, it's the center of all the theology, the mystical theology of Gregory, because he comments again and again. He says, "How can you say to the bride, arise and come, when you've already done that?" And he says, no, we climb, we rise in one particular circumstance of our lives, and then we have to rise again to go to the next plateau, the next level of the mountain. And that always stretching out to what lies ahead, forgetting what lies behind, quoting Philippians 3, that's the whole centerpiece of St. Gregory. This is mystical theology. It should be of our lives too. So he says, look, behold, the winter is past, the rains are over and gone, and the wildflowers appear in our land. The time of Zamir in modern Hebrew means nightingale, and that's the way it's translated here. But the Zamar in Hebrew means to cut. So it either means singing, because the various verses are, you know, the melody is divided into measures. So cutting the music is a way of keeping rhythm. So it sometimes means the time of singing has come. My nightingale is related to that. Or can mean pruning, cutting in that sense. So the time of pruning has come. That's the way that some of the commentators, the mystics, have interpreted it. It's this time of pruning the branches of the vine, you know, like Jesus says, the branches of my branches that do bear fruit, I'm the vine, you're the branches, you know, the Father, the vine dresser, prunes so that it may bear more fruit. So that was also one way it's interpreted in some translations. And then the song of the turtle, the voice of the turtle dove, is heard in our land. It's actually a play in English from the mid-20th century called The Voice of the Turtle. It sounds like it means a sea turtle or something, but it actually means a turtle dove, and it's referring to this verse. The title is taken from this verse, The Voice of the Turtle. The voice of the turtle dove is heard in our land. Interestingly enough, some of the commentators take that to mean John the Baptist. Just as the bridegroom's coming, you know, arriving in our world, as we've seen, then he is the voice of the turtle, as this winter begins to be over, is heard in our land calling to repentance, even though one is coming after him, whom we don't know, whose thong of whose sandal is not worthy to stoop down and untie. But the bride, winter's being over and gone. There's a beautiful passage here also from Gregory of Nyssa. He says, human nature was hardened like granite, caught fast in the ice of idolatry, incapable of movement towards anything higher, as we've been seeing. But now the sun of righteousness, the sun of justice, arises on this stern winter. It shines from the east. It brings the south wind of spring to melt what is turned solid and help soften the whole lump through. Man, who was petrified with cold, is warmed through the Spirit, softened in the radiance of the Word. He becomes once more water leaping up to eternal life. As the Psalm says, God will send forth His Spirit, the waters will flow. Psalm 147. When the stone is turned into pools of water, Psalm 113 or 14, the flint into fountains of water. So that's a commentary on what the work of the Spirit is as the south wind begins to blow and the winter is past. And the fig tree has sweetened its fruit, you know, it's the new green fruit, and the vines are in bud. Give forth their scent. The vines in bud, in that spring form, are giving forth a scent. Arise again, arise, my beloved, my friend, my beautiful one, and come away. So where is the dove now? Yonathi, Yonah. Remember, said Jonah is dove. So my dove. In the clefts of the rock, in the shadow, in the hidden place, literally, of the cliff. St. Bernard and others take that to mean in the clefts of the rock, to be the wounded heart of Christ. So you're hidden in the clefts of the wounded heart of Christ. Very medieval type of mysticism. I think Gregory of Nyssa speaks of it in terms of the book of Exodus, where, you know, God hides Moses in the cleft of the rock as he passes by, because he can't have his face be seen. God, you can't behold God's face and live. And he sees his back from the clefts of the rock. So that's another evocation that the Father has made with this verse. So we're hidden now with Christ in the rock, who's the rock in any case. So let me see, your, sometimes you see, just simply see your face, literally your appearance, what can be seen. So it's not enough, it's not really let me see your face, it's let me see the whole of you, the whole that can be seen. Let me see your whole beauty, all your beauty. Let me hear your voice, for your voice is sweet. It's almost a word that almost means sweetness of fruit, you know. The sweetness, your voice is sweet, and your appearance, again, your appearance, not just your countenance, but your appearance is lovely. Talk about plays from the 20th century. The Little Foxes, the next verse. Lillian Hellman, right? So anyway, not directly dealing with that. It says, catch us the little foxes. It doesn't mean catch us who are the foxes. It means catch for us the foxes. The little foxes that are raiding, invading the vineyards, and the vineyards are in blossom. So let's not the demons or any of the vices or any contrary forces get in the way of the vine, which is us, you know, our vineyards now being in blossom. Mm-hmm. And towards the end, this beautiful little verse, Dodi Li Wa Ani Lo, is still recited today. I've heard it in weddings, especially obviously Jewish weddings. My beloved is mine and I am his. Dodi Li Wa Ani Lo. You should be able to say that to the Lord. And he feasts among the lilies, Shoshanim. So Susanna means lilies, for the name. He feasts or pastures among the lilies, and it could mean he pastures his flock among the lilies, or he's just feasting himself among the lilies. And of course, that's very very erotic, a sense of is feasting on the bride, really. And finally, for chapter 2, and this verse again, this first part of this verse will appear later as well. Before, or just as the day breathes and the shadows flee, come away, my beloved, or go away, my beloved, come away, turn, literally, turn, my beloved, like a gazelle or a young stag on the mountains. We'll see that in a second, but there was a lot of question what time of day we're talking about here. The day breathes and the shadows flee. Now in the Latin traditions, but St. Bernard and others, they took it to mean the evening, the cool breeze of the evening. As it says in the book of Genesis, God walked with Adam in the breath of the evening. So the wind that comes up as the sun sets, and then the shadows flee, because as the sun goes down, the shadows get longer. So fleeing in that sense. As this book points out, makes a case for very well, it's probably the opposite. It's probably dawn. So you've had a night-long tryst, the lovers, out in the woods. And now, before the day breathes, so it's the breeze not of sunset, but of sunrise. When the air starts to move in sunrise. And the shadows flee because they're gone. The darkness of night is no longer there because the sun comes up. Who knows, maybe even the rising sun and the shadows lengthen in that sense too. But so it says, run away. So it's not come, my love, but run away, my love. So we spent the night together, and before anybody finds us out, we better get out of here. It's kind of the idea. So run away now. We've had our fun. Be like gazelle or young stag on the mountains of Beter. Some translations actually just keep the word Beter. They're not sure what it means, but it comes from a word, a root, batar, meaning to cut, again, cleft or divide. So they take it as jagged mountains, rugged mountains. Just as the bridegroom came leaping over the mountains to begin with, now he's at the end of the chapter, he's leaping away over the same mountains. So that's it for the first two chapters, and next time we'll begin with chapter 3. Hope we got that.
Yes.